Hello, overclockers. I'm Apex, a professional overclocker. And if you don't know about me, where have you been for the last 10 years? Well, what I'm here today to discuss with you is the new 13900KS CPU by Intel and the overclocking potential when you place that in the Apex motherboard that we have here by Asus and run it with some really fast DDR5 memory by Team Group at 7600 megahertz, and you'll see we'll be running it beyond that as well. Within that, we're also going to discuss a little bit about cooling the CPU to get the maximum overclocks. So, by the end of the video, you'll know whether this board and combination is a PEX or indeed a mere pigeon chest. Now, that all being said, of course, let's get into it. Okay, first, let's discuss a little bit about the 13900KS CPU by Intel. What this CPU is literally bringing is the same amount of cores and threads as the 13900K, so 24 cores and 32 threads, but what it's offering extra is much higher boost clock. Well, 200 megahertz higher boost clock, in fact. So this is offering 6 gigahertz boost clock at completely stock versus a 5.8 gigahertz boost clock at completely stock. To get this extra performance, Intel are asking a premium of around £100. And obviously, what we're trying to deduce really in this video is the CPU actually better than the standard K in terms of, is it a binned better CPU? Is it better not just overclocking the performance cores, but also the efficiency cores? Can the cache go higher? And indeed, is the IMC better for running high speed memory? And in the video, we'll find out about all these things. So now, moving on, let's discuss a little bit about the Asus Z790 Apex motherboard, which I have here next to me. Basically, this board's been used to break a lot of overclocking world records at Asus HQ, including it pushed the 13900K all the way to over 9 gigahertz, which is the fastest frequency ever seen in a CPU. It also has several overclocking features, which include a safe boot button, which literally means if you've pushed the settings too hard on the BIOS, you don't need to fully reset the BIOS and then have to start plugging settings again. You just press safe boot and it will boot at optimal safe settings, allow you to go into the BIOS so you can make minimal tweaks. So it makes the process of changing BIOS much more iterative and less room for error, if you like. It's got BLK overclocking buttons on the board, so you literally just push the button and it can move up BCLK on the fly. It's got ProBit, which is basically places on the board where you can attach your voltage reading modules, voltage meters, and get the exact voltage that's coming out of the VRM at any given time, not just by using software, which can be inaccurate. So you can read memory, you can read CPU volts and so on using those buttons on the board. It's got a retry button, which is often useful when memory overclocking. Sometimes memory will not pass memory training at maybe a certain temperature if you're using LM2 or if you're using chilled water or something like that. So with the retry button, again, you don't need to change anything in BIOS. You keep pressing retry and the board will continually retry the settings that you've already put in there without resetting. It's got a slow mode button. This is really absolutely used for high-end benching, basically to make sure you get the screenshot before everything crashes. You can run that bench, I don't know, say 7 or even 8 gigahertz. Once you finish the bench while you're taking your screenshot, etc., you can push the slow mode button and the CPU clocks right down to make sure that it's not going to crash while you're getting the results saved. It's got a pause button, which helps pause benchmarks halfway through, so you can try to regain stability. I mean, I'm not even sure if I particularly agree with that button, but they have included it. It's got an LN2 mode, which helps people using extreme cooling boot up at settings that are suitable for LN2 from stock, if you like. So reset the BIOS, put the LN2 jumper on, you can cool down the CPU to minus 50 and it's going to boot successfully. It's got a BIOS switch, so you can have multi-BIOS versions stored in there. So there might be on testing some BIOS versions that are better in, say, Cinebench, and some other BIOS versions that are better in, say, single threaded runs. So you can switch between BIOS versions very easily with the push of a button there. And also, which is pretty amazing on this board, It's got a form of condensation detection, which of course is very important if you're using sub-zero cooling, and will of course help you to prolong the life of the motherboard and other components plugged into the board, and indicate when you need to stop your session and start drying things out so as not to have any damaged hardware. So all those features are mainly useful for the very high-end overclocker or L2 overclocker, but also things like BCLK buttons can help when you're just doing some casual water cooling overclocking as well. Obviously, what's very appropriate to this kind of motherboard is a very strong VRM. This has got 24 plus zero power stages, each rated to handle 105 amps. Each power stage is accompanied by high permeability alloy core choke related. All of these can handle 45 amps. So all this came with a very accurate power stage with a lot of suitably spec'd SMDs means that it's supplying a crazy amount of power to the CPU sockets and also to the memory voltage modules, which are on individual DIMMs. Remember with DDR5, the voltage regulation modules are in the DIMMs and they're not on the board. So alongside all this crazy power delivery and very accurate power delivery at that, we've also got the very large heat sinks on the board to keep the VRM cool and working very efficiently. And all this is going to help you to push the memory to very high frequencies while remaining stable, and also to push the CPU to higher frequencies while remaining stable. Basically, the motherboard removes all the limitations that you've got in terms of maxing out the hardware that you plug into it. And I'll actually be honest and say that I really like also the look of this motherboard. It's going to fit into any like monochrome build very well, and also any white build very well. And the robust like industrial feel of it very much fits in with the 8-pack brand and the 8-pack system. So much so that I'm actually using this board in one of my 8-pack systems already, and you can check that out on our website. Right, finally, let's discuss a little bit about the memory that I use for this. I started off with a 5200 megahertz Corsair kit just to test the stock performance of the CPU versus previous stock performance that I'd already done on the 13900K. Then I chose 7200 megahertz and 7600 megahertz team group kits, which were CAS 36 kits. And both of those had the best overclocking IC currently available on DDR5, which is Hynix ADI, as the IC used on the PCB, if you like. And I chose those kits because I knew those would be the ones that I'd be able to get the highest frequency out of. And then what I went on to do here was to test indeed how high the memory kits would overclock, but also to test them not just how high, but how high they can go 24/7. So all the results you'll see here was with like 1000% mem test coverage, etc., etc., and are entirely repeatable by pretty much anyone, providing they have the right CPU and IMC to do so. So now let's look at some benchmarks with the stock 13900K. When you compare that to the stock 13900KS, both with the memory running at 5200 megahertz with an XMP profile. And what we saw in this is, yes, the both CPUs under turbo were boosting to the different levels as you'd expect. So the K was at 5.8 and the KS was at 6 gigahertz. And for this test, I'm using a 360mm water cooler, so it'll give you an idea of how the boost operates and the type of cooling I was using. And what the scores basically were for that was the 3D Mark CPU profile was better on the KS by 1.3%. The CPU profile when you're only using one thread, so effectively single-threaded performance, was better on the KS by 2.6%. We saw Time Spy CPU score, which is a AVX CPU score, again in 3D Max, it simulates gaming physics, that was 1.3% higher on the KS. The Firestrike overall score, which includes, of course, FPS in gaming and is at 1080p, was 1.6% better on the KS. Cinebench R23, which is multi-threaded testing, was 2.5% higher on the KS. And finally, superposition at 1080p was 2.4% higher, and Valley at 1080p was 1.7% higher. Now, as I've covered many times before, when you're testing a CPU, you want to remove the bottleneck from the graphics card. That's why a lot of the testing you will I will be reading about here or discussing here is at 1080p, because the higher the resolution that we run the benchmarking, the more the shift is towards the graphics card to give you the entire score. On all these benchmarks, yes, of course, I did use a 4090, and I actually did overclock that 4090, as I've done in all the testing before when I've been recently doing CPUs. But obviously here we're trying to check the memory and the CPU and the efficiency of the motherboard more than anything else, and that's why you'll read a lot of these benchmarks are 1080p. So in summary, what did I find at stock? Well, what I found is on the same cooling with the same memory, I was saying that essentially the KS chip over all this range of benchmarks, be it single or multi-threaded, was about 1.9/2% better than the K chip. And that's what you're getting essentially for your extra premium of £100. I mentioned what memory I used briefly earlier. Now let's discuss how I tuned it for this specific testing. Basically, what I got is 7200 and 7600 megahertz kits and the Apex motherboard here. I noticed on the new 13900KS that the memory controller had officially improved to include 8000 megahertz memory support. So I wanted to really check this out and see how far the Apex could push these kits. Now, my, if you like, test conditions were that the kits must run at XMP with the voltage that XMP states and be at least 1000% memtest stable to be considered worth running all the benchmarks in, i.e. is this memory kit at that frequency going to run your gaming rig or whatever you're doing day in, day out at that speed and be completely stable? Those were the conditions of going further on the testing. Now, what I discovered was that the 7600 R&D and indeed the 7200 team group kits that I discussed earlier, which was C36 at 1.4 volts, could all actually run rock stable at 8,200 megahertz, no problem. And you could even boot Windows at even 8400 megahertz or even 8600 megahertz, no problem. But they were not what I would consider gaming stable unless you push the voltage to the memory up above the 1.4 volts. So you had to push like 1.45 volts or 1.5 volts, which I decided was not what your average user will do. What was also fairly interesting was that what I found was that is the silicon lottery also getting to these speeds, not indeed with the memory kits or indeed this motherboard here, but with the actual IMC on the CPU. What I found basically was that every CPU that I tested could run these kits at 7600, no problem. But for the credentials that I've mentioned earlier. But once you start to push them higher, it was actually only 40% of the CPUs that I tried could run them above 8,000. And again, these 40% of CPUs could run them all the way up to 8,600 megahertz, but not stable. But these two CPUs that I tried could run 8,200 megahertz all day long, no problem. So that's why the final testing you'll see here, or the fastest testing, if you like, on the Apex board was at 8,200 megahertz. So finally, the overclocking. The hardware I used to test for the overclocking, obviously the 13900KS, the Apex board and the Team Group memory that we've already discussed. And then I added to that one of my 8-pack PSUs, and indeed I tried also with the Be Quiet PSU, and I used the 4090 with my standard Windows 11 install that I've used for all my other benchmark previously. Obviously, I want to keep the drivers and the settings within the OS as tight as possible so that these benchmarks are then comparable to what I've done with other CPUs with this vendor and also with others, so everyone can compare what we're getting with previous videos that are already on the Overclockers YouTube channel. So everything was as standard as possible. I used the same 360 AIO by EK, the Lux model that I very much like, with the fans set to the standard profile, and they pump maxed out at all times to ensure good cooling flow to the block. And what I was doing here, which I found to be the best way to tune these CPUs to keep temperatures, you know, within good ranges, is I was using the TVB plus 2 profile on the motherboard. So with that, the performance cores were boosting as high as 6.2 for single threaded loads, and up to 3 cores they were still at around 6.2, and then slowly cycling down as you added more and more load. And in general, the more and more load that you added, the closer to the 13900K normal frequency, if you like, they got to, and usually the normal frequency of the 13900K plus 100 megahertz effectively. And at the same time I was adding this to the P core, I was able to overclock the efficiency cores to a rock stable 4.6 gigahertz, and I was able to push the cache to between 5.1 and 5.2 gigahertz. The better samples of the CPU I could push to 5.2, the, if you like, worse samples but still very solid were to around 5 gigahertz on the cache. Remember, 13900K you could only push to about 4.8 on the cache, and 13900K you could only push to about 4.4 on the E cores. So you're gaining about 200 megahertz on the cache and 200 megahertz on the E cores with the KS. So now we've gone through my methodology, if you like, let's go through the performance benchmarks. What I'm now going to do is read out some highlights. Okay, so on 3D Mark times by Extreme, the CPU score increased by 5.6% when you overclock the CPU from stock to TVB plus 2, and also you ran 7200 megahertz memory versus 5200 megahertz memory. The change in the times by Extreme CPU score when you only went from 7200 megahertz memory to 8200 megahertz memory was only 0.3%, but still obviously an improvement. And you'll find that with a lot of these scores, that there is diminishing returns going from 7200 megahertz memory to 8200 megahertz memory. So the next, I suppose, pretty good leap in performance was in 3D Mark TimeSpy CPU score. Now this is running the TimeSpy render at 1440p, and we saw a 20.7% increase by overclocking the CPU with turbo velocity boost and overclocking the memory to 7200 megahertz when you compare to stock and 5200 megahertz, 20.7 being a really solid improvement. And then by going from 7200 megahertz to 8200 megahertz memory, we saw a further 1.6% improvement. On superposition 1080p, we saw 4.1% improvement with the 5200 megahertz stock setting versus overclock 7200 megahertz setting, and then almost 1% further going to 8200 megahertz. On Cinebench, which is a heavy multi-threaded test, we saw a 4.4% increase when overclocking and moving up the memory to 7200 megahertz versus just moving up the memory from 7200 megahertz to 8200 megahertz, where we only saw a 0.4% increase. And then finally, in Unigine Valley, 1080p, we saw a 3.1% increase from overclocking the CPU and increasing the memory to 7200 megahertz, against what was a 0.6% increase from going 7200 megahertz all the way to 8200 megahertz. So overall, the percentage of improvement from overclocking your CPU and raising your memory speed to 7200 megahertz across the whole benchmarks that I ran was 5.1%, which is actually a reasonable return for what is in the main free performance. But what we did notice is was that the improvement from going from 7200 megahertz to 8200 megahertz memory across the entire board of benchmarks, obviously some were better than others, some were close to 2%. But in the main, the average was only 0.5%. So that 8,200 megahertz goal overclock that I kind of set myself here for rock stable 24/7, you know, would only be, I guess, applicable to those who are absolutely chasing the maximum frame rates, or someone who is absolutely chasing the maximum performance in anything they run. I mean, 2% is not too bad, to be honest, improvement, but not 5% on something that's not running, say, over numerous hours is not really going to save anyone time or gain anyone a substantial amount of performance. Okay, so in summary, I really love the Apex board. I realise that won't be for everyone, but I want to push every last percent out of the hardware that I've got in hand. The 13900KS, as we've said, that's a bin CPU, and again, very suitable for what I'm doing, and obviously for anyone who really wants to strive for the last couple of percent performance, again, that's a great CPU. And finally, the memory, from testing, we can see here that 7200 to R7600 is the absolute sweet spot for the peak that you're going performance that you can get out of the memory while remaining stable, hence why I've chosen that in my bundles. And finally, of course, as usual, don't like the video, don't subscribe to the channel, but do check out the gigs.